Coming up next on Spotlight, we have joining us the author of Smells Like 5 a.m. Stay tuned. Welcome to Spotlight. I'm Allison H. Larson, and today joining me, I'm privileged to have Dr. Marlena, the author of Smells Like 5 a.m. in studio. So Dr. Marlena, what does Smells Like 5 a.m. mean?
Well, it's more than just a catchy phrase. It's actually a mindset. It's the mindset that pulled me literally back from the dead.
So take us through your journey, because you're sitting in front of me now. You look healthy. You look full of energy. So what happened? What brought you back from the dead?
Well, it started out, I was 39 years old, and my nest was starting to empty. So my kids were leaving, and my husband was doing his own thing. And I found myself with that void, feeling kind of empty. So I started eating, what most people do. And my weight started doing this. And then I thought, well, no, I'm not going to do that. How about, oh, I have another baby. And then little problem with that is 7 years before I had a tubal. Mm-hmm. And so, but the reproductive doctor said I was a prime candidate for reversal. But, you know, that but came. I needed to lose 75 to 100 pounds.
Wow.
So my quick fix, you know, in this instant world, my quick fix was to have the gastric bypass. So from the time I went in for the consultation to the time I was on the operating table was 6 weeks.
Wow. So only the time that you went in for the consultation about the baby.
About the gastric bypass.
Oh,
I
okay.
got the green light on the baby, but I had to lose the weight. So I started focusing on mm-hmm. that. And I wanted a quick fix because I figured I could have this baby within a year.
Yeah.
So I have the bypass, drop the weight, then have this baby. And I still be, you know, 41.
Right.
And still young. But the problem was I went in for the surgery and woke up 10 weeks later and found out I had been on life support.
What? So you went in for the surgery?
Yes.
Just expecting a routine?
Routine, 3 days in and out surgery, yes.
And you wake up 10 weeks later?
10 weeks later. Not only just waking up, I'm actually on a ventilator.
So when you're waking up, do you think you're waking up from the surgery?
Yes, because the nurse comes in and she's like, the things, your name, where you are. And she says, what's the date? Well, my surgery had been the 29th of the month. And I thought, well, maybe I slept all day. So I said, well, the 29th, 30th. And whatever 10 weeks later, she says, and I remember going, and I didn't hear anything. And I was like, wait a minute, I didn't hear my what. But what I heard was the machine. And then I was, you know, NG tube, mm-hmm. I was on the respirator, tubes everywhere. And I was like, oh my God, you know, what happened? And what I found out is that I had sepsis. And so I'm truly a sepsis survivor.
So, and explain to me what sepsis is, or for those people that are listening that might not know what sepsis is.
It's like a really bad blood infection. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, whenever you have this bad of a infection, you have the little brown bag over your penicillin, you know, kind of thing. It was so bad, my organs started shutting down.
Oh my God.
So, so the bypass got reversed. Mm-hmm. I ended up having, losing half of my stomach and half of my, and a foot of intestines, and kidney failure, liver problems. Needless to say, I was jacked up.
So, how close were you to death?
How close? I died twice on the operating table.
Wow.
I actually went back a few years later and saw read the medical mm-hmm. records and saw in there where they turned up the volume to zap me, you know, clear,
right.
You know, twice, because I had flatline.
So why do you think you didn't die on that table?
Because my purpose hadn't been served. God left me here for a reason. Short story, there were three of us went in for the surgery, and I know that because when you do the gastric bypass, you have to go to the educational piece of it,
mm-hmm.
and we went together. We had our surgeries that week. The surgeon had never had a fatality. I had researched that. That week, myself at that time was 277 pounds on the day of surgery. I was 39. There was a 38-year-old. She was about 320. The person who was 50-something years old, close to 500 pounds, 9 medications, walked out in 3 days with no issue. Mm-hmm. I had major complications, and the other mother didn't survive.
Wow.
All in that same week. So laying there on that bed, I realized I'm here for a purpose. And instead of having that remorse by why me, or, you know, feeling guilty about being here, I said, I'm going to get up out of here. When I leave this hospital, I'm going to do something great. I didn't know what it was. Mm-hmm. I couldn't even walk. I couldn't even talk.
Yeah.
I couldn't walk right. I had a coma in the sense, not brain damage, but more like an encephalitis state where the body just kind of, the brain shuts down to the body's diseased state. So it was a hard struggle, but that 5 a.m. moment, that 5 a.m. moment kept coming to me and helping me get better and better.
So explain that concept of the 5 a.m. moment, and what that meant to you, because what is really sticking out to me is when you woke up, I can only imagine going in for something what you thought was routine, waking up to find out that you actually died twice, and you have a long journey ahead of you, a long road to recovery, and feeling like you're finding a purpose in that. And I think that it's actually interesting, because I think there's been some research done finding that people that find a purpose in their suffering feel more encouraged, and they actually heal and recover more quickly. So you did that right from the get-go. You found your purpose. You found your 5 a.m. moment. But what does 5 a.m. have to do with you being sick and recovering?
So the 5 a.m. moment, years before, I had always been on the weight loss journey.
Right.
And so years late before that, I used to go to the gym. And 5 a.m. was my time, or if you would call it, my call time for working out. And I had a trainer. So I'd go in. And
that's really early. I do have to say, 5 a.m. is really early.
And
but
I
okay.
do it to this day.
I mean, you have to know that you're dedicated to be at the gym at 5 a.m. So you're dedicated to working out. You're there at 5 a.m.
In the car, 4:45, 5 o'clock, I'm at the gym. And I walk up to the desk. And the trainer says, oh, smells like 5 a.m. And in the beginning, didn't like the trainer.
Right.
The trainer was mean to me.
Oh, who likes their personal trainer, right?
Give me another rep.
Yeah.
And give me another rep. And before I knew it, I'd done a whole set.
Yeah.
And sometimes two. So that's I truly believe at 5 a.m. you're at your best. You can go that extra rep to go that extra set. And so that's the mindset that I tapped into when I was laying there in the hospital bed.
So smells like 5 a.m. means that when you think you're done, you can do one more.
Yes. When you hit that wall, turn to the wall and squat.
Yeah.
That's what it means. And so I squatted through 6 months of being in the hospital and learning to everything, to shower again, comb my hair again, the things that we take for granted. The first day they said, we're going to get you up to walk. I'm thinking, get out of here. I've been walking since I was a baby.
Yeah, right.
So they get me up. They put you on this thing like a cot. They strap this big belt around you, and they stand you up. And when my feet hit the ground, I buckled. And had the belt not been holding me, I would have crumbled to the floor. But in my mind, that was God holding me in place until I could get my footing and start on my journey for my purpose.
Wow, I love that. So how did that mindset of just one more step, just one more thing, what were those moments in which you drew upon that? I mean, obviously standing up for the first time, feeling like you're about to buckle and fall. What were some of the other instances where you had to use that mindset just to make it through?
Well, when they were wheeling me down, I didn't eat solids. I didn't touch solids for at least 6 months. Everything was a feeding tube. My feeding tube fell out, and they had to put it back in. Or it got infected or something, they had to fix it. And they're rolling me to put me in sort of, I guess, like an MRI kind of thing to see where to put the line and all of that. And the guy walks on the elevator and says to me, you're the lady. I did your dialysis. And I'm thinking, dialysis? I didn't even know all that stuff had happened to me. And that was the first moment, and I finally faced death, that I had been that close. Mm-hmm. And I was, that again, that 5 a.m. moment said, you didn't come this far, just stop. God's not going to let you go at this point. You have to finish the journey.
Wow.
And that's why I was able to tap back.
So it's a 6-month struggle. You're using this 5 a.m. principle to get you, to keep you going. Obviously, you learned how to walk, to talk, to brush your hair. You're fully functioning. Now you're back to normal. Or maybe even better than normal. I don't know. Better than normal. So what was the moment when you said, okay, I've got something here, and I feel like I need to share it with people?
When I have 4 boys, and one of them had a little challenge in school. And we were trying to get help for him for school, and there was none. And I got to thinking, well, gosh, there's nothing in the schools for the child. What is the parent going through? And I said, and I had this, remember 5 a.m., remember your journey of purpose. You still haven't started living it. And so I became on this quest to learn information and knowledge so I could help the next mother. And then I thought about it. There's another mother, 39, sitting out there, that her nest is going to be empty. She's going to feel some kind of way about where she is and who she is. You need to tap into your 5 a.m. moment. You need to get on your purpose, and you need to get going.
I love that. You know, I'm 39 years old, so you're here. You're speaking to me. I'm sure we have people listening. Maybe you're 39. Maybe you're not 39. Maybe you're just saying, hey, I want to have more of these 5 a.m. moments in my life. So how long was it after your experience that you actually got your book published?
14 years. It's taken 14 years to finally get
Well, you look great. I was going to say, you know, I'm doing the math here in my mind. You look great.
I am happy to say I will be actually 54 coming soon. And so I'm excited about that.
Well, you know what I'm excited about? I'm excited about coming up after this break, because you're going to share with me and with all of us some of the tips that you have in this book to help you find your, to help all of us find our 5 a.m. moment. And if there's anybody listening right now, these are tips that you want to write down if you what?
If you are wondering, what is my purpose and how do I pursue it?
So what is my purpose? How do I pursue it? I'm sure we've all wondered that in our life before. And I'm sure, you know, I don't even think we ever get to that point where we feel like we've fulfilled our purpose. Hopefully we're growing, we're living, we're continuing to do that. So get out your pens, get out your paper. Coming up next, we'll have more Smells Like 5 a.m. with Dr. Marlena. Welcome back to Spotlight. I'm Allison H. Larson, and joining me today is Dr. Marlena. If you're just joining us, Dr. Marlena, you've shared your journey with us of how you had a near-death experience going in for a routine gastric bypass surgery, waking up 10 weeks later, finding out you died 2 times on the table, and then having this really struggle to get back on your feet. You had to learn things like how to walk, how to brush your hair, how to talk again. And what got you through all of this was this concept of Smells Like 5 a.m., this 5 a.m. moment that kept you going, this mindset that you can do one more set, you can do one more rep that you learned from your trainer a while ago. Mm-hmm. So you actually decided to write a book about this.
Absolutely.
14 years in the making.
14 years in the making.
But here it is, and it's now available. And what do you talk about in your book? Because, and here's where maybe it gets a little personal for me. I'm 39 years old. My kids are leaving the nest. And you talked about how that was what triggered you to get this gastric bypass surgery. You wanted to have another child. So what would you give, what would a tip that you would give for somebody like me that's wanting to find her purpose in life?
Well, on the identity part, because losing my identity, because whether we want to confess to it or not, we identify by being a mother or the director at work or the wife.
Right.
Right. So our identity. So when those things are stripped away, then you were questioning, who am I? You know, so the first tip is we always think about the great ones, the great people who do the great things. Well, we have to think of ourselves as that great person.
Oh, that's interesting. So, like, I think of great people, I'm thinking of, like, Oprah. You know, Oprah's this great person, and she's in a totally different category as I am. So you're saying that I should put myself in the same category.
Absolutely. You are a great person. So I am a great person. So that's the first. part of the TIP. So the great person comes from being having that entrepreneurial spirit, mm-hmm. and taking a widget, for example, taking that widget all apart, putting that widget back together, and with a little tweak to it, a little twist to it. And it's the same widget, but now it's improved, and it can help someone maybe do something differently or better. So we have those minds. That's who we are. We are that great person. We don't have to really look outside to figure out, you know, who we are, because we have it in here. And by tapping into our purpose and aligning to our purpose, we start to figure that out.
So how do you look within to find that greatness? How did you do that?
Well, for me, I had to. Ecclesiastes says it's a season for everything. Mm-hmm. So I didn't know or understand or even know why or how, but I had this feeling in my soul, in my spirit, that there was something more that I should be doing. Mm-hmm. Lean into that feeling, right?
Yeah.
And explore it and allow time and God to drive you toward whatever that feeling is taking you toward. Be open to it. Just that's the second tip. Be open to whatever.
Right. Well, and I think that can be hard sometimes, because I think a lot of the times we feel like we should be content, we should be happy with what we have, we should be grateful, and I think all of those things are true. But what's always bothered me is when people say, well, I'm just happy with my life the way it is, and yet I'm feeling this drive of like, I have something greater to do, I have something more to offer the world, but yet I'm feeling this pull like, well, shouldn't I just be happy with my life? I've got these four beautiful children, I'm living in a beautiful place, I have great clients. So what's the balance? How do you balance that out?
Well, it's funny you say that, because I grew up in a time when we had manicured lawns and Friday night fish fries.
Right.
And, you know, football and drill mm-hmm. team and cute boys. And, you know, I married well the first time, and we traveled and we had a good life. But then I felt unfulfilled, got remarried, had the four sons, bought the home. So you would have thought by the time I'm 39, I would have been like content. Mm-hmm. But that feeling I just was talking about, mm-hmm. knowing that there was something here pulling me into doing something else, I kind of squashed it down, because I didn't want to feel selfish.
Yeah.
By doing
I think that I love that you brought up the selfish thing, because I think that is a lot of women struggle with that. Yeah. We mm-hmm. feel absolutely selfish for pursuing our dreams.
Yes.
I don't know if this is a mindset that's just been around for a long time, or if this is just more of a feminine way of thinking, but women are really service oriented. And I think we get a lot of our pleasure from serving other people, but we have this mindset that it has to be the people in our home. Like if we're mothers, it has to be our children, or it has to be our spouse.
Absolutely.
Or it has to be our parents. But really, we can serve other people as well, right?
Absolutely.
Not feel guilty about
it? Not feel guilty about it. And that's part of also following your purpose, because you can be whole. You have to be whole inside yourself before you really service any, because if you're not 100%, mm-hmm. you're not doing anyone else any justice.
So there's nothing wrong with any of us women that are thinking, hey, I want to do more for the world. I want to serve outside the home.
Absolutely.
Nothing to feel guilty about. I love the second step that you brought up too, because you talk about being open to what?
You're open to whatever's possible. Mm-hmm. You're discovering what's possible for you. I like to use this example about a cookie. You know, I make a really good cookie. It smells good. Everybody loves my cookie, but I won't go out and try and pursue making this cookie commercially, for example, because the shelf space is so limited. But it's okay, because maybe my cookie's not supposed to be on that shelf. Maybe it needs to be in a basket in the hospital for someone, or at the senior living facility for someone. But there's so many other avenues I can go out with my cookie, but I'm keeping it really limited to what I can see. That's where sort of a Dr. Marlena comes online, mm-hmm. as resource can call and say, hey, there's possibilities, let's explore them together.
So when you're being open and exploring those possibilities, part of that is letting go of the vision or idea that you may have in your mind.
Yes.
And just saying, I'm going to be open to what God has to
exactly.
plan for me. I really like that. Have you any success stories that you can share with us?
Well, I am an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. I have four barbershops. We had a movie location business, for example, and we started with one home and grew that to 36 homes.
Wow.
And then the industry and life and real estate happened, and that's gone. And then we then we moved into travel. So I do travel. So I keep it moving with a whole bunch of different things because I'm serving different communities of people.
Well, being open and also being able to shift is also a trait, I think, of a good entrepreneur, right?
Yes,
because things are going to change. And if you have one mindset, one focus, one thing that you want to accomplish, mm-hmm. and then something changes about what you're doing, then you're going to lose whatever you have unless you're being willing
Absolutely.
To change.
And the market's changed, and you can't. We had Bar and Grill, and we did great for 8 years, and then all of a sudden the area changed, mm-hmm. and the consumer coming in changed. So, you know, had to let that go. And know that it's not a failure that we had to let go. It was time that season was over. Many people don't understand that about seasons. So sometimes you're in the season of hard planting. Then you have to till the soil and do all of that. Then you're in the season of when it's over. But you have to end for something new to start.
Great. So tip number one is to really recognize the greatness within yourself. Start seeing yourself as great. Quit seeing yourself as the little fish in the big pond. Quit realizing that you're a big fish. I mean, start realizing you're the big fish in the big pond. Tip number two is just be open to all different possibilities and what God has planned for you as you're feeling pulled towards your purpose. It may not fit in the box that you think it's going to fit into. What's your third tip?
And the third tip is this. Prayer. Perseverance, patience is purpose.
Okay, wait, say that one more time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Prayer. Perseverance, patience leads to purpose.
Okay.
I need to explain them though. So the prayer is to get aligned. You have to get in alignment and hear what God is saying to you about that feeling you're getting. And I like to put it here because it's not a feeling that you or a thought you get here or a feeling you get in heart. It's that if I don't do this burning feeling down deep here, something's going to happen.
Yeah, it's like that gut check feeling.
Yeah, I got to move this. That's the feeling I'm talking about. So you get in alignment by praying. Then you move on to persevering because when you start praying and you start moving on that feeling, perseverance here, because you're going to need it to block and knock down those obstacles that are going to come. Because now that you've sort of changed in your mindset, those stumbling blocks are going to come.
Oh, they will absolutely. I mean, I've seen this over and over again. As somebody really figures out their purpose and starts going for it, I mean, there's opposition after opposition after opposition, and I have various thoughts on why these come, but be prepared for those to come, because I've never met a single person who has had a great purpose in life, who's accomplished that purpose, who has not had to overcome obstacles.
Absolutely. It's called life.
That's true. I mean, we can stay in the same place. We can kind of stay stuck and never move forward, never have those obstacles, but you're right.
Right. And then here's the big one, though. Patience. God says three things.
So not patient. Okay. Inspire me, Dr. Marlena, because I need this one.
God says three things to us. He says yes, and we're all for that.
Yeah.
And he says no, and we're kind of okay with that because we get closure. But when God says wait, we don't know how to.
Yeah.
We don't know how to gracefully wait.
Yeah.
But we have to wait for the right season. And I talk a lot about seasons because, again, Ecclesiastes talks about there's a time for everything under the heavens. And so we have to get through that season of drought, get through into that season of plenty. And we just have to be patient. Here's the killer for some. Maybe it's not in your lifetime. You have to wait until it's in your children's or your grandchildren's lifetime for some things to materialize. But to have that patience to be faithful to continue, you do get some reward in there.
So what do you do in those moments where you're like, I just don't want to wait? What do you tell yourself?
Just keep working.
Keep repping.
Mm-hmm. Keep repping. You're going to get stronger.
Yeah.
Your muscles are going to get bigger. You don't see it. We laugh about, you know, when you're worked out and you're really buff, and when you look in the mirror, you still think you're small.
Mm.
You know, even when it's me losing weight, and I'm sure people can relate to this, we lose weight and we still see ourselves in that same body image. And someone will come through and says, oh my God, did you lose weight? And you'll be like, oh, can you see it?
Yeah.
It happens to us every day. So, but you just hold steady until the season changes into the best part, your purpose being fulfilled.
Wow. So all of this is in your book.
Yes.
How can somebody get your book, Smells Like 5 a.m.?
Two ways. My website is called Purpose and Letter N Passion.com, or email me, Marlena@purposeandpassion.com.
Wow, it's been such a pleasure to have you with us today, Dr. Marlena, and she wrote the book Smells Like 5 a.m. So, Dr. Marlena, if you could look at this camera right here, for everybody watching, what is your last piece of advice?
Align to your purpose. Let your passion flow. You'll never work again. And let me clarify what I mean by that. When you're working within your passion and your purpose, you get this sense of peace. That feeling you had here goes into this funnel and this peace. I can't even explain it to you. I still have chaotic days. You'll still have chaotic days. But something about having God on the throne, you're under the throne, your chaos gets aligned.
Love it. Dr. Marlena, everybody, Smells Like 5 a.m., and we will see you next week on Spotlight. I'm Allison H. Larson. Thank you so much. That was really great. I loved that. I got goosebumps as you were talking to the camera. How did you feel about that?